This conference will now be recorded.
Well, you see, I would have visited Ferozepur. It's a place where I have studied. My schooling was done. Professor Arora had been very kind to invite me for delivering this talk, waste to energy. You see, waste has been a big problem. We have an MTech program at IIT Delhi, Center for Energy Studies on environment and energy management. There we have different, you know, subjects and hazardous waste management, industrial waste management. The subject is also there. And executive engineers from Central Pollution Control Board, Ministry of Environment and Forest, they also attend those MTech programs because it is an evening program. It used to be. Now it has been shifted to day. So it's a morning program now. Earlier, it used to be evening program, and I used to interact with them, and they used to also drop me at home. One way I used to discuss with them about the waste. Waste is something, you know, is waste management. I think whenever I visit Germany, whenever I visit USA, I stay there and then I feel very bad, you know, about India. Especially when we come back after 1 year, we see everything very, very dirty here. So there everything is very clean. And one reason is, of course, population. You know, we have, India is a very populous country. It will be number one after maybe a few years. And then you see another problem is migration. I have myself migrated from Ferozepur to Delhi, but that was long back in 65. Migration is something, you know, people, when I used to study in my school in Ferozepur, I used to study that 80% of the people in India live in villages. Today, it's around 70 or maybe 65% even. So people are migrating, maybe they're just seeking for the jobs, you know, there are more employment opportunities in the cities. But as a consequence, you know, they put a lot of problem for the waste management on the municipalities, you know. And then you see the other problem is NIMBY, not in my backyard. Where do we, you know, dispose of this waste? Whenever I used to give a lecture there, I used to go to organization to give a lecture. On way I used to pass through Balaswai. There's a place in Delhi. There we have a landfill site there. Horrible, you know, whenever the car is passing through Balaswai, you can see fire emanating, dogs scratching the ground, vultures, of course, nowadays vultures are extinct. Other birds are there, crows are there, you know, kites are there. They dig the ground, take out bacteria, and they dig out the waste from that landfill site. And I feel very bad, you know. The fire is, smoke is emanating. I was involved with this, you know, waste to energy project through my MTech projects with Central Pollution Control Board, fellow biomedical waste and all, treatment and all that. From vice president, joint director now in Central Pollution Control Board. So, and then you see National Green Tribunal, NGT, here. They had appointed me to monitor waste to energy plants in Delhi. And I used to interact with Delhi Pollution Control Board and Central Pollution Control Board. And I used to monitor all the three waste to energy plants in Delhi. So today I'm going to share with you some of my knowledge in this area, waste to energy, and what I have seen.
You have this slide.
Yeah, waste to energy. In India, you see, we are generating 62 million tons of mixed waste. And then there is an annual growth of waste generation, 4%. So Waste generation in India may go up 5 times by the year 2030. And Planning Commission, you know, Niti Aayog is very much worried about that. Hello. Can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. It is audible.
Okay. Waste generated in India may go up by 5 times by 2030. Delhi generates 8,360 tons per day waste. And roughly 40 to 60% waste is biodegradable, 10 to 20% recyclable, 30 to 40% construction waste, dust, soil, and inert waste. Well, you see, that is the picture of one of the Dalos in Mayur Vihar phase one extension. That's the place where I live, you know. It's a posh area. IFS people live here, big people live here. But you can see the Dalos where they have dumped the waste. You can see the picture. You can see the cows happily eating there. They eat plastic also. You can see the plastic waste. In the previous session, I was talking about cat cracking and other things, pyrolysis, that can be done. Nuclear waste, you know, the disposal of nuclear waste is still a problem. It's not like that, you know. One has to properly manage it. But anyway, waste to energy, you have nuclear fuels, you have already use them for energy, and very minimal you can use them. Well, you see, earlier we used to have one solution, that was landfill. Population was not that much. And we used to dump, as in Delhi, we have Bhalaswa landfill site. Ghazipur is another. So a lot of problems were there in these landfill sites. There were frequent fires due to methane accumulation. And during rainy season, you had soil and water pollution, a lot of animal pests, etc. They used to breed and they used to dig the ground, take out the bacteria, and it's a big health hazard, you know. So that is why they landfill, they have exceeded, you know, their design capacity, so no more waste can be dumped there. So that is why they thought about the waste to energy plants. This could offer solution to waste management, especially in big cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Pune, etc. Niti Aayog planned the generation of 800 megawatt power from waste to energy plants. There are a lot of advantages of waste to energy plants. One is reduction of waste volumes. Another is avoidance of landfill space requirements and leachates, etc. near urban areas. The other advantage is you may also process unsegregated waste and you can generate electricity and heat. And the ash can be easily disposed of, and the ashes may be used as manure even. You know, they are doing at one place in Delhi. Technologies are available, incineration. There are waste incinerators working well abroad. And it will generate employment, and several technological choices are available. But then there are problems also for waste to energy plants. Rag pickers, they pick up the plastics, paper, etc., which can give calorific value to the waste. And then there is only presence of moisture, raw vegetables, fruit, etc. The calorific value of the waste is very poor. There is presence of construction waste, dust, dirt, etc. It may lead to breakdown of machinery. And then there are emissions from the plants. You may have dioxin, furans, smoke, SOx, NOx, CO, fly ash, hydrocarbons, particulate matter, etc. Power generation unit problems may be there. There may be incomplete combustion. since 1987, 12 waste to energy plants were set up, more than half are shut. Main issues: waste segregation, low calorific value, costs of power generation were the major problems. I remember, you know, 15 years back, I had visited waste to energy plant in Timarpur. They had imported this plant from Denmark. The plant failed, you know. Earlier they used to add some coal, etc. JK Synthetic used to run that. But then it was imported from Denmark, the Danish technology was there. But when I visited, I saw a lot of construction material was there, you know. They were just picking up that, putting that into the boiler. So that's the problem. Calorific value of the daily waste was not good enough. We are generating 142,566 metric tons per day of municipal solid waste, MSW, in Delhi. And about 80% of this is collected. In India, you know, we have 94 landfill sites. Number of refuse-derived plants, that is, you remove the RDF, refuse-derived fuel, is the fuel content, organic content from the waste. There are about RDF plants 25, number of waste to energy plants 5, 3 units operational in Delhi, 1 unit in Pune. Well, that I've seen, you know, net some. I thought, let me share some pictures with you which are available free. This talk of paper waste, paper is also waste, it can be recycled. This waste to energy plant, tire waste are being burned, you know, crumbling tires, then burn them, then you get fuel out of it, you get electricity out of this. Another waste to energy plant, you know, you remove recyclable glass, plastics, etc. from this, then burn it in the boiler, combustor, incinerator, then extract out heat in the heat exchanger, then you use steam, you have gas turbine, and you can send the flue gases for HCl recovery, sulfur recovery, SOx recovery, etc. And sometimes you can also get water, distilled water. Another, you know, picture of waste to energy plant abroad, very nice pollution control system for air pollution control, and you generate power. Beside incinerator, you also have compost plants. You know, there are 553 compost plants where you dump the waste, and you have vermiculture, you have other microbes, and anaerobic microbes, which convert these into manure, compost. Then there are biogas plants. MNRE has set up a number of biogas plants, 56. Maharashtra is the leader. Well, I've taken this figure from my student, Mr. Bharat Sharma, who is now the joint director in CPCB. He delivered this lecture IIT finished when I organized IIT Finnish University workshop at IIT Delhi in 2016. Well, the government, the Ministry of Environment and Forest, is very strict. They have solid waste management rules upgraded in 2016. They want to promote the management of hazardous and non-hazardous waste, and these should be treated, and the waste to energy options should be promoted. RWS, Resident Welfare Association, market, hotels, institutions, restaurants, etc., they have been cautioned by civic agencies that they should manage their waste properly. And some are putting up compost plants also, and using their grass there, park grass, etc. And they're trying to manage the waste. A number of technologies of this energy plants are available. You have incineration, that is, waste or solid waste can be incinerated. Biogas generation, anaerobic digestion, you use animal dung, fecal waste, human fecal waste, food and vegetable waste, etc. Sewage sludge, sewage waste, these can be treated through anaerobic bacteria and they can convert this into biogas, which is a mixture of methane and carbon dioxide. You can scrub out carbon dioxide, then you have calorific value, methane, high calorific value gas, and you can use as CNG, compressed biogas. Then there are rotary kilns, you know, cement industries. These are like Lord Shiva, you know. Here, you know, hazardous waste, plastics, sludges, etc. can be treated. Temperatures are very high, 1500 degrees centigrade. And all chloride, sulfate, etc., they lime sucks them. Calcium sulfate is very good for cement making. And the like Lord Shiva, you know, it absorbs the poisonous, the hazardous waste. Then gasification is another technology. MNRE is promoting it. Organic waste can be gasified. And you have micro generators, micro turbines, you generate power. Then plasma gasification is another technique where you can treat hazardous waste. And Prime Minister Modi is promoting Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. And there is Akshar village in Guwahati. They are treating, they collect plastic waste as school fees, you know. Items of plastics or houses, they collect from the student as fees and they teach them free. And plastic bricks are converted into bricks, plastic bricks, and they make houses, you know. So these are different initiatives by entrepreneurs, schools, colleges, etc. Then you have fermentation, biodegradable waste can be fermented. Then biodiesel formation, that is possible with the hotel waste or the domestic oil, cooking oil, waste oil. Then bioethanol production, agro waste, cellulosic waste can be used. Fuel cell power generation, you can use urine, sorry. You can use plants, you can use algae, and you can have microbial fuel cells. Landfills also give methane gas, you know. Then liquefaction or hydroliquefaction is another technique. This picture, you know, this is the picture of the landfill site at Ghazipur, you know. Ghazipur is a place near Mayur Vihar, near Noida. There we have a landfill site where people, you know, they are very much crying, you know. So you can see this dump, you know, 2-3 years back during rainy season, it had fallen down and 5 people died, you know. So it is as high as Qutub Minar. So I just wanted to share this picture with you. I had visited this because I used to look after these, monitor these plants. We have 3 incinerator plants in Delhi. Delhi generates 8,000 metric tons of waste. So 2,000 tons per day is treated in one. So we have 3, so 6,000 TPD. Still 2,000 is remaining. Cases are going on for the land. I don't want to get into that. Okhla waste to energy plant is there. Capacity is 2,000 tons per day. Power is generating 16 megawatt. Then Ghazipur waste to energy plant capacity is 2,000 tons per day. They are generating 12 megawatt. Waste to energy plant, you know, they have a segregation and they have Trommel screens, different, you know, sizes, mesh sizes of screens. And then they have magnetic separators and plastic is segregated and it is sent for recycling. And the remaining waste, you know, organic waste is sent for, that is called refuse derived fuel, RDF, that is sent for combustion in the boilers. Bhavana waste to energy plant capacity is 2000 TPD, it generates 24 megawatt power. They are generating manure also. So I used to monitor this plant. Well, that's a waste to energy plant at Okhla. A lot of court cases are going on in NGT. There, people are crying. A lot of foul smell comes and a lot of problems there. Well, as I told you, I was in Germany in 2016 as a Alexander von Humboldt Stiftung Foundation fellow. So I visited the incinerator plant at Magdeburg, a small city in West Germany. It used to be in West Germany, a big city, but relatively smaller city of Germany now. But they have Max Planck Institute, Fraunhofer Institute, the university is there. One professor one day took me along with his students to visit this incinerator. One person was running this whole plant, you know. They are treating 300,000 tons of MSW. It is incinerated annually. 170 million kilowatt hour of electricity is generated, and 300 million kilowatt hour of heat are generated per year for 44,000 households in Magdeburg. Whereas the cold area, they need space heating, so they are using that heat. Well, in India, biogas digesters are very popular. MNRE has a large program. More than 50 million digesters have been installed in India. Wellsard in Gujarat, they have presented a very good example of septage, fecal waste to energy. They are using cattle dung, organic waste, and they are generating biogas and biomanure from that. They are using fecal waste along with the cattle dung there and generating biogas. So that's a good example. Well, you see, in Germany, they use whole of maize plant, you know, its population is very less, and they then have a lot of maize crop. So they use the whole maize plant and generate biogas and then generate power. Well, this photo I have taken from the net. I had attended Indo-Norwegian workshop on bioeconomy at Nibio, Oslo, Norway in 2017. They invited me to attend this workshop and give a lecture there. So there I had a chance to visit Romvike biogas plant at Oslo, Norway. So they have clicked my photo there, and they have put it on the net. One day I was just looking for my name, DK Sharma, Norway, I put, and this, I could see this picture, so I picked up that picture. I thought I'll share with you. What they are doing in this plant is they are converting 50,000 tons of food waste to biogas and biofertilizer. And methane is made free of carbon dioxide through scrubbing with high pressure water or lime water. Then methane is liquefied at minus 162 degrees centigrade, and then it is used for running the city buses. Well, you see, in India, IOCL has set up a plant, 15 TPD compressed biogas plant. I'm a member of Green Energy, you know, WhatsApp group. So there they shared this information with me. The IOCL is using chicken litter, poultry waste, and pest mud they're getting from sugar mills. And these both are being utilized to produce compressed biogas at Pudu Chatram in Namakkal district of Tamil Nadu. This is used to produce compressed gas after recovering CO2, removing CO2. The cost of CBG compressed biogas, ₹59.42 per kilo. A small car would give 27 kilometers per kilo at the cost of ₹2.20 kilometer, which is substantial saving. IOC, Indian Oil Corporation, envisages a target of 15 million metric tons of CBG from 5,000 plants across India by the year 2023. So that's a good move. Well, then we come to treatment of hazardous waste, and which can be incinerated in cement rotary kiln. I have attended several conferences of cement industries and have found discussions on this. And I also had a chance to interact with, you know, Dalmia Cement Bharat. Dr. Narang used to be vice president there, and I used to be their consultant. So hazardous waste, you know, can be treated in the cement kilns because the temperatures are fairly high, more than 1500 degrees centigrade. They use calcium oxide, lime. So any sulfur, any chlorine will react with that, give calcium chloride, calcium sulfate, which will improve the quality of cement also. And it will be fixed there, you know. So it is a sort of a, you know, example of circular economy. Circular economy means, circular economy is a part of, when the part of waste from one chain of economic activity becomes an input for some other productive economic activity. So that is called circular economy. So cement kilns are good example of circular economy. At least 4 to 5% of cement is used there, you know, in rotary cement kiln. Use of plastics, thermal power station, fly ash. In India, you know, our 70% of the power comes from coal, burning coal, and Indian coal contains average of 35% ash, bad quality. So we generate more than 150 million tons of fly ash every year. That fly ash can be used for making cement, blended with the cement, pozzolana cement. And then we can also use slag from steel plants that can also be used. And this is an example of circular economy, as I discussed with you. Plastic waste is a problem, you know, single use plastic, which Prime Minister Modi also keeps saying. Plastic waste cups, bottles, sacks, etc. were found in whales in Indonesia. Ocean bottoms contain a lot of plastics, especially microplastics. That is, you know, a lot of plastic is wasted in India. That is because of lack of incentives for collection and selling of plastics, glass bottles. Maybe we should put some GST or tax benefit for recycle of plastics. In Germany, you know, when I was there in Germany, whenever you go to any grocery store and you buy some soft drink bottle or beer bottle, they charge you 25 cents as fan. So that fan, you know, is for those bottles. And then they have a machine. When you have consumed this soft drink or beer bottle, you go there, put the bottle back into the machine, it will crush it, and you will get back your 25 cent receipt, which you can use in the grocery stores. So that is one way of segregation of plastic waste. So segregation of waste is very important, and that was a good example in Germany. Well, you see, at IIT, we have been working on waste to energy project for the last more than 30-40 years. I have conducted IIT Finnish University's workshop on biofuels and waste to energy in 2016. And we discussed a lot of IIT Delhi R&D work and other IIT what they are doing in the area of waste to energy and biomass to energy. We discussed there along with Finnish professors. Then we have done a number of MTech projects at Ghazipur Incinerator. My MTech students have gone and worked there. And we have found that calorific value of the daily waste is poor. So we have advised them to use MSW or to use agro residues like stubble, etc., along with the MSW to enhance the calorific value of the waste. So you can use agro residues and other waste, plastic tires, etc., in cement plants. Then we have done an MPEG project on hydrolysis of fruit waste, pineapple peels, banana, mango peels, and papaya peels to produce bioethanol and fertilizers. So this paper we have published. Then we have worked on microbial fuel cells. We have developed this, but we have used urine, we have used algae, we have used sugar industry waste, food industry waste, soap industry waste in that microbial fuel cell for generating power. Then we have done some work on co-cracking of bakelite with bagasse, with coal, with biomass, with petroleum vacuum residues to produce fuel. We call it reactive co-cracking, you know. So different, you know, when the plastics and other things, they crack into free radicals, so they may react. So it's a reactive co-cracking. We have used polypropylene, bagasse, coal, petroleum vacuum residues, got the fuel, We have used different catalysts. We have done kinetic studies, product characterization. We have done reactive co-cracking of jetofoil with bagasse. Use ZSM5 NEMO catalyst. We have done kinetic studies. We have done product characterization. We have been working on jetofoil and NGP, petroleum vacuum residue, reactive co-cracking. We are interacting with Professor Crocker in Center for Applied Energy, University of Kentucky in USA. And we are doing pyrolysis GCMS studies also on these. And one paper we have already published in collaboration with him. Then we have got graphene from CO2 by burning magnesium ribbon, very simple. We have used those graphene for production of polycarbonate, graphene CNT nanocomposites, and production of or synthesis of polystyrene nanocomposites. We have used the graphene for CNT, which were derived from CO2. We have worked on biogas production from lignocellulosic biomass using animal dung, scrubbing of the CO2, production of biodiesel from seed oil, jatropha, and from gummy oil, teal oil, and algae. We have used hotel, restaurant waste, cooking oil can also be used. We have done one project with a student from IOCL R&D, Dr. Rajesh. He has worked with me. We have produced green diesel. We have used jetofoil with vacuum gas oil. We have filed US patent. We have filed Indian patent. Published a number of papers in Petroleum Science and Technology Journal. We have worked on getting bioethanol from agro waste. We have done enzymatic. We have worked on acidic hydrolysis. I've worked on developing the concept for smart refineries, biorefineries. At DBFZ, Deutsche, Biomass, Forschung, Zentrum, Leipzig. I worked there for 3 months in 2018. And as I told you, I've done a lot of MPEC projects with students from Central Pollution Control Board on biomedical waste or other waste. I have worked with a student from Aizawl. She had done her MPEC at IIT in civil engineering. She was executive in municipality in Aizawl, so I worked with her on this waste, Aizawl waste, management of Aizawl waste. One of my students works in Sulabh International, so we keep interacting with her on setting up biogas digesters. One of my students has worked on solar detoxification of waste by using titanium oxide as a catalyst. Waste management practice is very important, as you all know that waste management is an essential service that has not stopped even during corona pandemic. This unprecedented situation presents new and significant challenges for the provision of waste collection services to the organizations responsible for collecting and handling such waste. The livelihoods of at least 1.5 million people depends on collecting, sorting, selling, and recycling waste in Delhi alone. Therefore, this grave situation calls for greater emphasis on segregation. From our side, as an unsegregated waste will not be recycled or fetch money for ensuring the safety of workers involved in the waste management. This I wanted to share with you. That is a waste dump, you know, you can see there's a need for segregation. All sort of waste is dumped there. There are tires and all sort of waste is there. In IIT Delhi campus, they want to do a survey. User and resident engagement is key to effective waste management on campus. This survey seeks to analyze the perception among campus residents about the segregation of waste. One day I had also gone and collected the waste, plastic waste. You know, all it was for all faculty, you know. Cooperation and involvement of residents to promote Swachh Bharat mission or Unnat Bharat mission. Well, that's the waste management. Used vehicles are just dumped for a long period. You would have seen on some roadside or in some societies. You can see cars, cycles, rickshaws, or scooters dumped for years together. You can see the unsegregated waste, see the child waste, you know, earlier they used to burn even tires, and there's a fire, sometimes accidental fire, it's a pollution hazard. Well, that is a waste incineration plant. You can see the night, how does it look like that? Our current utility scale plants around the world, this figure shows that combustion incineration is still the major type of technology used, while gasification and anaerobic digestion are still in the minority. There's a list of at least 13 companies dealing with hazardous waste management. In conclusion, I would say that segregation of waste is very important. Single-use plastic, we should be very careful about those. Swachh Bharat Mission, Unnat Bharat Mission, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas is very important. Another thing for the authorities, they should put in good number of dustbins, you know, so that people, in Germany, I used to see a lot of dustbin. So if you are eating banana or anything, you see the dustbin around and you can immediately dump it there. And there is a wide scope of generating energy from waste. One example is Jain Irrigation Industry. I had gone to Jalgaon to conduct one wireless examination, PhD wireless examination in North Maharashtra University. So there I came across one plant in this Jain Irrigation Industry. They had put up a waste treatment plant, 1.7 megawatt power they are generating. Feed is fruit waste, 120 to 160 metric tons per day. Biogas generation, 14,000 to 16,000 meter cube per day. 28,000 to 38,000 units electricity generation. They use it for refrigeration. 10 TPD organic compost. So they are utilizing for grid interaction. CBO of MSW may be enhanced by blending with agro residues with waste incinerator. Pyrolysis also seems to be a good option for waste to energy plants. Even stubbles may be utilized to get briquettes, steam, and power generation. PRESPL, that is Punjab Renewable Energy System Private Limited of Colonel Manish Ahuja, is doing a lot of work in this. Hazardous waste will be utilized by cement industries. Incineration, anaerobic digestion, gasification, and pyrolysis seem to be good option for the waste to energy plants. Well, you see, waste to energy, one, I was reviewing the DBT projects. DBT is doing a lot of work. Sewage to bio-CNG plant, DBT. We have a Barapula sewage, Barapula, there is nala is there, you know. Drain is there. So DBT has a project from IIT Delhi, of course. They want to treat 1 million liters of sewage per day and generate bio-CNG. And in India, about 15% sewage is not treated, you know. And about 17,000 to 18,000 million liters of sewage is not treated in India. So if that is treated, then you can generate power. You can collect organic waste also from that nala. That is also one project going on from IIT Delhi. Then we have a sewage treatment plant at Keshwapur that generates biogas. Earlier plan was to run the DTC buses, but now I think that has not taken off yet. Then bio toilets, DBT, Terry, and Solab International, they have installed about over 2 lakh bio toilets. They have been installed in 61,000 trains, coaches, by railways. Ghazipur dump landfill waste, you know, DBT, they have a project to convert that into biogas. That dump, Qutub Minar, you have seen, big Qutub Minar height. Dump, pulp and paper industry waste and MSW can be converted into biogas, butanol and lactic acid. That is also one project of DBT, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. Then they have project for converting CO2 to microbes and electrochemical conversion to alcohols. They have projects of converting MSW to energy. at Goa, Hyderabad, and Mumbai. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I've gone through their progress book and I've seen those projects for PBT, and I just wanted to discuss those with them. I have a first-hand information of the waste-to-energy plant, whether in India, in Delhi, or I have also visited one refinery in USA. I was working in a project of Environment Research Forum, Petroleum Environment Research Forum, for 6 months. So Mobile was the leader. So I've seen their waste treatment plant. They are very nicely treating their waste, treating the microbes there. So in India also, I've seen IOCL plant, waste treatment plants. Thank you very much, and I would be very happy to answer your questions. Any questions?
Thank you, sir. Now, one by one, participants can unmute the mic and ask the question.
Okay.
Hello. Yes. Sir, good afternoon. So thank you very much. Hello.
Can I put my earphone? Because I will hear better.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Hello. Ha, sir.
Yes, sir.
Actually, my question was, actually biogas is obtained in the anaerobic digestion process.
Right.
So in that process, actually the digested what is obtained, so how are these digested being used?
Yesterday I used, I think I'll remove my earphone. You have floating gas digester, you have the other digester, fixed pipe digesters are there. They are working well. Even in distilleries, I have seen the digesters, they are working very well. You should have water, sufficient water. And then dung, you should have cattle dung or buffalo dung, maybe the poultry waste. So you press smart, they're running properly. IOCL is putting a lot of biogas. Only thing is you have to be careful about the temperature and the pH. pH is the major issue, 7.1. That you have to maintain. Sometimes you have to add lime, sometimes relaxing is added. There are experts in running those digesters. So biogas digesters are running for the MNRE has said a lot of Janta biogas plants. And one of my students, he has been setting up non biogas digesters, removing CO2 and selling methane. Yes. Any other question?
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Yes. Yes, please.
Sir, how to digest this slaughterhouse waste and lethal biomedical waste?
Well, you see, slaughterhouse waste, a lot of blood and other things would also be there, and then the unhygienic conditions would be there. And of course, during biogas digestion, those things will. But my concern is before that, one has to be very, very careful in those running slots. But then MNRE has put up on its site, All you have to do is to visit MNRE. I've been interacting with them. So they have the booklets for all waste treatment. So just go through those step by step. They have explained everything. I'm not an expert on slaughterhouse waste treatment, but I know the source. They can tell you. Talk to them. Talk to my student, Prof. Sharma. Send him an email. He will send you all details how to do that. It's not a big problem. You get by the way. Yes. Any other question?
Sir, incineration of biomedical waste leaves a lot of odor and with a deadly pathogen in the air. And the only method is landfill or to go for anaerobic digestion. So is there any plant in India exists who are digesting this lethal biomedical waste in this anaerobic diet?
You see, the thing is that for hospital waste, biomedical waste, I've done a project with my student, Mr. Sharma, and we have helped quite a lot with the biomedical waste. The best treatment, of course, is your incineration, you know, because you have to burn all those germs, you know, the bacteria, virus, etc. You should burn them. That is the best solution. The other is plasma treatment, you know, is coming up. Plasma torches are there. So you have plasma treatment. So through that, you can kill the germ and then incinerate that waste or pyrolyze for that. The biogas digesters, etc., I won't be very comfortable with that. Handling germs and other things in biogas digesters, do you think it is really a wise thing to do? I won't be comfortable. I don't know. I won't be comfortable. If you have sterilized that waste, then you want to go in for biogas digester, but then there are all sort of dressing material is there, also segregation could be involved, health hazard could be there. It's better to burn it. Why not? Just get rid of those things, you know. They and hospitals, they have incinerators. They have installed incinerators. And the air, the flue gas is treated, you know, it's not let out just like that. One has to be careful, you know, you have to, the flue gas treatment has to be done. Yes, next question.
Thank you, sir, thank you.
Yes, please.
Hello. Sir, actually, I have also one more question to ask.
Yes.
Sir, actually, conversion of waste to energy is actually a very difficult task, actually, I would say. Because segregation of all kind of waste biomass is a very difficult task nowadays. So collecting, harvesting all kind of waste biomasses as well as waste plastic from different places is a very difficult task. That is why I think in most of the places, actually these plants are actually not being installed, I think. So actually, I'm working at the Centurion University of Technology Management, Odisha. So actually, here it's a very rural area, sir, where our university is situated. But we are planning to install a plant here, particularly biogas plant, and that is a pyrolysis plant. Not very large scale, but in pilot scale, we are planning to install it. So, but because of that problem, is actually we are unable to. Actually go for that. So can you suggest me, sir, actually what can we do, or what could be done for that, so that we can go for this kind of thing?
You see, you would have seen, you know, a few years back, Amir Khan had run a program in TV. I do not want to comment on that. I don't want to get into that. The thing is that these all issues are the ones which the authorities are really tackling each day. So waste to energy plant, you are right. There are many issues in that. One is not in my backyard. Once I had gone to purchase a land, you know, that fellow showed me a land. Then there was another agent. He came to me. He said, don't buy this land. He said, why one waste treatment plant has to come here? Incinerator plant. And court case is going on. So not in my backyard, NIMBY. So that issue is there. And then you see the running these incinerators and segregation of waste, all these are big issues, you know, where DPIO is very concerned. It's a big problem. That is why in Delhi we have only three incinerators, and all three incinerators, a lot of court cases going on, public is really crying. But then you see the question is, you are generating 8,000 tons of waste per day. Where do you take it? In Ghazipur, you have a dump site high as Qutub Minar, and people die, you know, because of the accident, you know. And now they want to convert that into biogas. So there are parties coming there. These are all, you know, very tricky issues, and one has to be very careful. And many things are involved. How much waste is there? How much organic matter is there? What is the what are the really contents in that organic matter? What is the daily variation in the that waste? What is the average, you know, quality of that waste? What are the average contents? And then you can design a plant. And then you can decide whether to go in for incinerator. And if you go in for incinerator, then they also start talking about the dioxins coming. That high temperature dioxins are coming. They used to telephone me sometimes that, sir, I've seen smoke coming out of that. I'm not running that plant. I am only monitoring. I'm concerned. But, you know, occasionally some smoke would have come. So these are issues, you know, very difficult to decide. Unless you go to the site and do study there, there are consultants, there is CPCB, Ministry of Environment and Forest is there. They take up all those problems. In one lecture, I cannot give you a solution offhand just like that without looking at what sort of waste you are generating, how much you are generating daily, how much can be subjected to anaerobic digestion, and what is the pH and all that. There are many issues involved in that. And one, of course, these are two technologies. You can go in for even the gasification also, partial combustion, updraft gasifier, downdraft gasifiers. That technology is also there. So you can look at that also. So many issues are involved. You see in the waste, only construction waste is there. 80% is construction waste. There are raw vegetables. If I'm getting a lot of raw vegetable, raw fruit, I will go in for anaerobic digestion. So one has to see, you know, and then decide. Often you cannot just say like that. And of course, we know the solutions are there, and you have to pick and choose which will be better. Incinerator, there are problems, but then there are problems in biogas digesters also. Availability of water is there, pH change, temperature during winter. There are many issues. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Sir, one question in chat box, it is written that is there any fund provided to install a common biogas plant at the village level? Have you any idea about this?
You see, I keep attending THD CCI meeting. You know, that Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Punjab Arena, Delhi Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Best thing would be you should contact them. And they may be able to provide some funding support to that. And then, you know, MNRE and the ministry, you know, this ministry, CPCB, you should contact them. They may be able to help you in that. We have a CPCB office in Delhi, and then Punjab you also will be there, you know, pollution control committee will be there. So you should contact them, and they will be very happy to help you.
I would like to add here that tomorrow we have two sessions on biogas plants. So maybe that expert will tell exactly what are the funding opportunities available for biogas at the ground.
MNRE is also interested in biogas. They are putting a lot of biogas plants. And then, you know, these agriculture people, there are rural ministries there. There are other ministries also which can provide funding support. And DST, of course, is there. And of course, because of Corona, a lot of funding is being cut. So that you have to keep in mind. But anyway, funding is available. And small project can be given to CSIR also, EMR, extramural research.
Yes, sir.
And MNRE, I think, should take up. They are interested in biogas plants. And rural ministry is there, so they should take up such issues. Yes.
Any other participant would like to ask the question? We have still some time.
Any other question?
Sir, I have a question. Hello, sir.
Yes. Yes, please.
Hello, sir. My name is Prachi. And sir, I would like to ask you, like as you mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, that India tried to, India got a plant from Denmark, but it failed in India. So from your experience, can you tell which waste-to-energy plant actually works in India and it's the most efficient in your experience?
You see, we are still, you know, having teething problems in waste-to-energy plants. The only thing is that waste treatment starts from the household. We should put different bins here. As in Germany, I used to see they have different bins, you know, for glass and other things, biodegradable waste and other things, paper, plastic. So different bins should be there. The waste should be segregated, and plastic can be recycled, glass can be recycled, metal can be recycled. So like that, you know, the waste first should be segregated. And then the segregated waste, when it goes to the incinerator will not, you know, have problems. And then it will function properly. So that is one thing. So far, the waste incineration plants are just, you know, going through the learning curve. That's what I would say. It's a learning curve, you know. So they are learning, you know. And then they are, I remember, you know, I had gone to Bhavana, waste treatment plant, waste to energy plant. They told me, sir, a lot of this manure is there, you know, there's no taker, and a lot of plastic things are there, you know. So sometimes it happens, you know, sometimes that can get into that, it is not their fault. So sometimes that can also happen, and people are not picking up that manure, so they can't sell it. Sometimes it happens. It may not happen always.
Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
Yes, sir. I'm Pradeep from Chennai. I have a question related to waste to energy conversion. You have told all about good parts of waste to energy conversion, and I'm also doing some research in converting waste cooking oil into useful biodiesel to be used in engine. So yes. I have good knowledge about what you told, but you have an expertise knowledge and you have said that. I want to know about the other side, sir, which is negative side, which is the disadvantage of using waste energy method. So it will be impacting, like, it is like, what I learned is it is expensive, it is still polluting the environment, and it is still making some damage to the public health. Like, and what all you know about the disadvantage is part of using waste energy methods, sir? Can you please explain?
See, the main thing is that you see, you do not have land. There's a migration from villages, from rural areas to the cities. People come in search of employment. I myself migrated from Ferozepur to this place long, long back, 65. So that way, you know, they are putting a lot of pressure on the municipalities in big cities. So the waste keeps on increasing 4% growth in the waste. And then standard of masses is also increasing. We also use paper napkins. So the amount of waste generated is also increasing. So that is putting a lot of pressure on municipalities. So coming back to your question about the oil. No, IIT, Dehradun, CSIR, IIT, Dehradun, they have converted this cooking oil, waste cooking oil, into biojet fuel. And that they are also in the, flying the plane also, in the flight also, they have used. So it has been successfully tested. So that technology has been developed. And they have also calculated how much cooking oil in India would be available, waste cooking oil, from the airplane, water, sources which can be used for getting biodiesel. The main disadvantages have land for dumping the hazardous waste. So hazardous waste sites are important. So land is to be reserved for that. Then big cities, you know, cities are expanding. Delhi going to Noida, Faridabad, another NCR. So Bombay, you know, expanding into suburb. So there is no land for, you know, putting landfills. So incinerator, at least you have problems with the incinerator, but the waste gets reduced to only few ashes, you know, and that can be used as a manure also. So like that, there are solutions, and the Niti Aayog wants to generate 800 megawatt power from the waste in India. So it's not that Planning Commission or Niti Aayog is not aware of this problem. So they are seized with this problem, and they are working on that. CPCB is working on that. Actually, it is Swachh Bharat Mission, you know, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, like Modi ji keeps telling. That is required in this also. All of us have to, you know, contribute and help, as we have done a survey in IIT Delhi campus. So everyone has to, waste has to be segregated, then waste treatment will be proper. You know. And those disadvantages won't be there. And there are problems galore, numerous problems are there. So those will be solved. And there is learning curve, you know, as we do, you know, we do get teething problems, and the problem gets solved. We are running three incinerators in Delhi, and we want to continue to run them. One in Pune. So it's all going on, you know. It's required. We need energy, you know. And waste should be converted into energy. Why not? Fruit waste, we can get bioethanol from fruit waste. So like that, you know, there are issues, and you know, as far as R&D is concerned, you know, you can work on any problem. But when it comes to real, you have to set up demonstration plants, then there's a learning curve, and you learn, you modify, redesign, modify the design, and move on with the things. That is the thing. Waste to energy is a big topic, a big area. So, any other questions?
Okay, sir, one more question related to the same thing. When the government is investing more on hybridization and looking for some alternate to the fossil fuel technology, why haven't the government been spending for these kind of technologies like waste to energy conversion? I don't see much of these technologies being supported by the government, except the fundings from BST or CSIR, and that's it. And not much like the government supporting for the hybridization or some electrification of vehicles, because I consider vehicle to be the most polluting part rather than the industries. So that is the reason why I'm asking this, sir.
So you see, you are talking about bus. In Delhi, we have CNG buses, very less pollution. Now they are going in for the electric vehicles. So they are looking at that, and then they will go in for lithium-ion batteries and solar energy. They are putting in a lot of, they are generating 63 gigawatt power solar. Wind solar is now matching wind power generation. It is fourth now. Coal is a polluting fuel, so they want to switch over to solar. And solar problems, I also discussed in one of the meetings. I discussed with Dr. Srivastava from Niti Aayog. I had posed a question about disposal of solar panels after 20 to 25 years. He said, still we have a lot of time, and we will find some solution to that also. But right now our problem is CO2. So they have to meet that commitment, you know, 30 to 35% reduction of CO2. So they want to go in for bioethanol, solar, and wind energy, and all that. But there are issues, you know. I was in Germany, and I used to travel with my wife on train. And in Berlin, I used to see a lot of windmills. And I have always seen those mills idle. Mills were idle. I used to tell my wife, see, this windmill is idle. It runs in the night time. Night, we need very less electricity. And storage is a big problem. You have to take the power all the way to Switzerland from the mountain or hills, you throw it down and store it somewhere or regenerate. So pumping storage is there. So there are all sort of problems, and there are solutions, and they are working on those. there are a lot of problems in the energy environment area. Any other question?
Sir, one more question I want to ask. Sir, actually, regarding e-waste, electronic waste, so e-waste contains many kind of harmful elements like lead, cadmium, even semiconductor materials like silicon, and all kind of things are present in the e-waste. So then how can we utilize the e-waste for production of energy? So in a proper way.
See, electronic waste, we have done some projects at IIT Delhi. So there are technologies for recovery of gold and all those things, cadmium and other things with metals, hazardous metal, you may say. But those can be recovered from computers, from TVs, and from other things. There are technologies available. You can leach them out and reuse them, recycle them. And the other plastic waste can be sent to cement industry. And then you see, this is a cradle to grave story, which I teach my students when I teach them hazardous waste management. See, cradle to grave story is that polluter pays. The person who has manufactured the TV set, he is responsible for the, he has to take care of that waste, you know. The polluter has to pay. That is a, you know, tussle between the plastic people and the cement people. You attend conference, plastic fellows will say, we are giving you this waste, pay us money. Cement industry says, you pay us money, we are treating your waste. So it is the polluter which pays you. The polluter has to pay. That is the principle, polluter pay principle. So that is the principle, cradle to grave story, you know. The waste has to be recycled, you know, all these electronic waste. It has to be recycled, and the plastic which is used there should be given to cement industry. Let them burn it. And the other waste will be fixed there in the cement. And for years, hundreds of years, it will be fixed in the cement. So no problem. Only thing is valuable, you know, the costly metals like platinum or gold and other things, those should be recovered, and the technologies are available for that. And it is being done. Electronic and electrical waste treatment technologies are there. You see Wikipedia, you see the encyclopedia are there. There are books on these, how to recover those things from the waste. And energy can also be recovered. If there is a plastic, where there is a plastic, it can be found. So you get energy.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
Sir, one question on chat is that how can we increase the percentage production of bioethanol using food waste?
Bioethanol production from food waste.
Yes.
Well, you see, the thing is that basically food waste, you are getting starch. So starch is subjected to hydrolysis, and then you get glucose and all those amylose and other things, and that is fermented to get bioethanol. So it all depends, you know, what sort of, I have reviewed a number of papers on this only last month. I think at least two papers on this I have reviewed. The thing which, question which I had put to the authors was that they should analyze how much starch is there, or carbohydrate. What is the scenario? How much carbohydrates are there? Because it is, after all, carbohydrate which is going to be converted into glucose, starch is going to give you glucose or amylose. That is going to be fermented to your ethanol. So often it cannot be answered like that. But if there is a wheat grain which is, you know, is there in the granaries and storage, that is being fermented to get bioethanol. In US, they have a technology, they are doing maize. In fact, that's how the food prices have gone up in US. So that can be done. But increasing the yield, you are a chemical engineer. Am I talking to Professor Arora? So the yield, you know, is that depends upon the your source material, starch in this case, or cellulose. That is hemicellulose, cellulose, that is multiplied by 1.1, and that will be your glucose yield. And that glucose will be fermented to give you ethanol. So there are constraints you have to calculate stoichiometrically, how much you can get. Beyond that, you cannot improve. But then once you are doing process intensification, you are using the proper temperature and other things, the microbes will do their job, and stoichiometrically you will get. You can't go beyond that. There is a limit. So up to that, you can, if you are following the same conditions, temperature, etc., proper, then there is a limit to which you can increase. If you are getting less, you can improve it by improving the conditions, fermentation conditions. But beyond that, you cannot go. So as such, you can't improve, you know, you cannot get something out of here. So stoichiometric limit is there, and you have to control the conditions, and you will get the, it's a well-known technology. No boosting business, there are biocatalysts which are used, and stoichiometrically you will get there. We have worked on food waste, and first we have analyzed the contents, then you know how much we are getting, and only thing is you have to see what are the carbon and see all microbes are there, you know, all yeast can ferment, you know, C5 and C6 sugars and dextrose and other sugars. They those can have glucose, mannose, arabinose. Those can also be fermented, you know, by the yeast which you are using. You are using baker's yeast, and there are other yeasts now available, and there are bacteria, simultaneous agarification technologies are there. So that can be done. Any other question?
I think, thank you, sir. It's almost time is over. And once again, thank you very much for this excellent talk on a very emerging area, waste to energy. I think everybody will be highly benefited. And I'm hoping the same type of feedback as the previous one. So thank you very much. Thank you all the participants for a very disciplined behavior during the presentations. Our next talk